born bad.
Who is hard drinking.
Husbands and wives.
A million teenage girls become pregnant every year.
Stripping moms.
Wild party loving moms.
They killed without remorse.
Lesbian mothers and their kids who are torn apart.
They're getting stoned out of their minds. Robbery, gunfights.
Your free tickets to attend the live taping.
Give us a call at 1-800-29-JOKE.
Give us a call 1-900-SPEAK-UP. The bill will cost you
$1. What is it exactly that talk television replaced? I mean, we didn't just come into a vacuum and invent hours in the daytime. We replaced game shows that were totally mindless, soap operas that exaggerated and distorted reality.
Seeking to relieve Ellie's fears for Vanessa and Carol.
Along comes the Donahue Show in 1967 in Dayton, Ohio, and we had Madeline Murray O'Hare, who on the very first program said, there is no God, there's no heaven, there's no hell, there's no angels. When you die, you go in the ground and you become biodegradable. Along, well, I'm telling you, all of Dayton, Ohio just began to dissemble.
Listen, I get two sentences out, and you act like you're gotta in the toilet, you know? It's like, listen, why don't you shut up?
I'm disappointed that you're so...
I'm disappointed in you.
You're so incapable of functioning.
I'm totally incapable of... I'm a misfit. Haven't you realized? I'm a misfit. I don't fit in to this plastic TV show with this plastic TV personality.
He started on the phones. He would talk to people on the phones. I started in Washington, D.C. with a show called Panorama. Mine was a show in which... there was no CNN. It was like a Today Show at noon.
Entertainment is the last thing I'm looking for. If I happen to entertain you in the process, then fine. But really, my goal is to try to uplift, encourage, and enlighten you in some way. I'm looking for the moment that makes you say, aha, I didn't know that.
Oprah came along. She became a national star. We were so really very impressed and felt very threatened by her power. We didn't know how many shows the daytime schedule would accommodate.
I came in to talk to expose the phonies who were holding the little guy down. Little girl, little guy.
Why don't you shut up? Why don't you shut up? All you're doing is spewing garbage.
I have the power right now to have you put away for a very long time.
You can talk to him.
I have something to tell you. I've been having an affair for the past 5 months.
So what once titillated and attracted us in drama is now attracting us with real characters from real life situations who are on the stage and often encouraged to be animated and scream at the other guests by the producer of the program.
You bring me out to Chicago for me to find this out on TV.
I'm sorry.
As we know that noise will stop the channel surfer.
Did you deliberately get pregnant without telling Andre?
No, you're a liar.
No, I'm not a liar.
You are a liar!
You didn't do that?
No.
Yes, she did.
No,
yes, she did.
Donna Short, did the condom break?
You saw what I did compared to the program that's being produced by many of my rivals, people like Jerry Springer and Jenny Jones and Ricky Lake and Richard Bay, and I could go on and on. I'm doing Masterpiece Theater now.
First couple of times we had sex, it was unprotected. I'm pregnant by him.
Try and remember one thing, and that is, we are professionals. We're in this business to make money. To make money, we have to get ratings. A lot of times to get ratings, we have to make you look stupid, not ourselves. And we will always opt to make you look stupid, all right? So if you want to be famous for being stupid, make sure you're a guest on a talk show.
Secret, 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 secret.
Andy, I know you spent a lot of time together with her. This is a secret she told us about you.
Why, Terry, do you say those awful things about Rhonda?
Because she's a drug-wasted, irresponsible idiot. She...
Okay, so the guests who, by and large, occupy or populate the typical talk show, that's the job of the producer. That's why these talk show producers get paid such fabulous salaries, because it is such a daunting task. You can book a guest on Friday, they'll cancel on Saturday, they'll rebook on Sunday. I have a saying that, you know, data talks and bullshit walks, and that's it. You know, you get them, and they deliver, and you've done it. If you had them and they didn't show, then you don't have it.
Stephanie and Delora live together, along with Stephanie's husband, who's going to be on the phone. His name is Mike. Stephanie is absolutely at her wit's end with Delora. Delora slept with Stephanie's sister's husband. Delora calls up Stephanie's husband's work and says they do drugs in the house. They're constantly fighting. The police know them on a first-name basis. She wants help. Stephanie really wants help. She's tried to kick her out, but Delora says, I'll kill myself. Mm-hmm. And Stephanie's at the point where she just can't deal anymore. She's calling us really for a lot of help. Delora is very soft-spoken, doesn't know why Stephanie is so mean to her, says Stephanie tries to control her life.
In 10, 9,
okay,
8,
ready BT 9, ready card.
7, 6,
stop the applause.
5, 4, 3,
roll 9,
2, 1.
Our job is to make sure that the program, while seeking the largest possible audience, doesn't become a pandering piece of crap that does more harm than good.
David, can we update her, Chiron?
What do you want to tell her?
Be kind to her? Why? She is a lying, backstabbing whore, okay? Do you hear that? She has done so much to me.
Just learned from best friend why she broke off their friendship. Okay? That works.
Crashed my house, put my jewelry in the litter box, okay?
I know damn well she did it. She's tried to tell me now for 8 years she didn't do it.
She looks like she's high.
Big grudge.
And this girl
slept with my sister's husband,
who was my daughter's father. Okay?
Now, that's not a friend.
But that makes sense, does it? Just that family tree.
That is not a friend.
You want them to trust you. And if you're not an engaging person with a personality, and you're on the phone, you never see, these people never see you. They just hear a voice on the phone, so that's all it is. This remote person in New York City calling them in their little hometown, and they're shocked, they don't know.
But I have tried to be a friend back and show her what friendship is about. Okay, and it's not about winging goddamn nice into people's backs.
Look at Delores, she's just laughing. She doesn't
and
care.
And she still lives with me. And she still goes behind my back and calls me a bitch and everything.
She ain't got no room to talk. This girl ain't got no room to talk.
Why haven't you asked Delora to leave years ago, Seth?
Because I'm an idiot. Hey, don't sit there like that.
No, I'm not.
Yeah, open your mouth. You did it for someone else. I'm sorry. Okay, that was, okay, that's a whole nother show about my sister Mary and my daughter's father, okay? But, you know, speak.
She doesn't want to speak, leave. Speak, speak.
What about the sister's husband, the father of Stephanie's daughter?
The sister's husband, the father of Stephanie's daughter, that does not make sense.
The sister married the father of her child.
She's got to, like, stick up for herself here.
But, Jeffy, you call me and tell me to
call. What's going on? Why is he bringing in Greer? Why aren't they screaming? Oh, my God. The worst. Because it sucks. Because they're supposed to scream? Hey, will you come out and help me do it? Thank you.
And I'm going to take a commercial break, and you'll tell us the rest of the story.
I'll remind the mics on the phone.
What? Talk back to me.
Here we go, everybody. Lots of energy. 10, 9, 8,
7, 6. Women at war with each other, former best friends, now engaged almost a kind of a mortal conflict. We're hearing the extraordinary story of Stephanie and Delora.
I told her, you know, we have to hear, you know, your side of the story a little more, you know. You're letting her run roughshod all
never. Stephanie, how long have you been married to Mike?
8 years.
Yeah,
8 years.
Mike,
the
22nd
of this month.
Yes, I am, Geraldo.
Okay. Hi, honey.
Hi, sweetheart.
No, for the record, Delora was not smiling when Mike's voice was heard. Okay, now, Mike, what do you want to happen with this relationship?
I'm afraid, like, if you clean cobwebs out of a dirty building, the walls are going to fall. But it isn't a healthy relationship. I would rename this. Instead of a friendship turning into battleship, I would say battleship ready to sink.
They, for the most part, contact us first. Sometimes we'll track them down. But, I mean, they've made the call originally, so they're crying out for something. And all they're looking for is somebody to talk to sometimes. And as long as you become their friend or honest with them, they'll trust you. And that's really the only trick of the business.
I want you to respond to her.
You're still fine.
Okay.
The rule we try to adhere to is never outright lie to anybody. Never. I mean, that's what I tell every producer, every AP. Never tell an outright lie to a guest. I mean, sometimes we will, you know, go around the corner or whatever, but never an outright lie.
I've been with Geraldo for almost 2 years.
Has it been your only gig in TV?
No.
What did you do before this?
I did investigative news work.
Like what?
I used to do, for a news magazine, I used to work in their investigative unit to undercover stories.
What show?
Inside Edition.
Are these good guests?
Yeah, they're good guests. Now they're great guests. Now they're good guests.
They're not excellent guests.
The definition of an excellent guest is different for every show.
What's the definition of an excellent guest on this show?
Resolution. Getting from point A to point B and back.
Did we do that today?
If these guys go home feeling that way, yes. If they go home with open wounds, no. There's a difference.
Do they have to do that on the air?
No, but...
You have to have resolution on the air?
So I have to have resolution on the air? No. Would I like resolution on the air? Yes.
That's the problem. Like, if I do try to talk,
go ahead.
She don't listen to nothing.
This girl doesn't talk. That's the problem.
She never talks to me. She doesn't even try to talk to me. You
well,
don't
ever everybody else
try
in this room be quiet and let the Laura say something.
You don't ever try. This is the first time I've ever seen you get my face in the mouth. I'm goddamn proud of you for trying it. I think it's good. Maybe I could respect you. Maybe we could work something out here. But you have never come up in my face, but you'll go behind my back at work, and you will tell people
here,
shit.
Come here. Okay. Yeah. How are you?
What's happening? Why didn't you
because
want...
Because Stephanie has let this woman live in our house. Now, I don't take sides, but I knew that Dee was going to get really upset. I knew Stephanie's upset, too. But she doesn't talk.
Are you pretty blue right now?
No.
Now, how do you feel? Tell us how you feel. We want to hear from you. No one else is going to talk in this whole room. Just you.
And me, maybe. I'll ask a question.
What's going on?
How are you reacting?
Fine. I just don't like you.
She's being attacked.
No, she's not.
That's like not being attacked?
She slept with her sister's husband.
What does it do to you?
She yells at you.
It gets me upset. I just wish we could talk instead of fight.
And when it gets you upset, is it the upset that you get talking face-to-face with a friend, or is it...
This is where Geraldo gets screwed, though. Yelling at you. This is where he comes in and he can deal with it. So there might be resolution on the air.
Maybe
if you move down the block and you could be friends, like, every Saturday or something.
I got into talk so I can do real stuff with real people.
Everything she can. She can sure use this mouth behind my back, but in front of my face she won't use it. She will not. I have begged her to talk to me. I begged her to yell at me.
You get so pissed off, then you lose your temper.
I lose my temper? You're the one that jumped over the balcony on my back.
No.
Don't you even go there, lady. You jumped over me.
Call the
police. So I would call
the
police on you because you would not.
Thank you. Thank you.
You wanted to go to bed. You were up there causing shit with me. I had a doctor's appointment the next day.
I had a mother's daughter kind of for you. Things were... But a real friendship. But don't see each other for a month or two. I mean,
the woman wanted to fucking put cyanide in her food.
Do their thing for a while. You do your thing. You've got a job. Maybe.
Yeah, but how do I know she means it this time?
Just give it a try.
She's like a bad seed.
You know, we're almost out of time.
Thank you very much for watching.
I mean, you have to remember, we do 200 shows a year, but there are seven shows that they talk about. And, you know, all these many years later, they're still talking about Geraldo getting his nose broken. I mean, it was 8 years ago. They're still talking about Al Capone's vault, which was 10 years ago. Geraldo walks down the street, and like it was yesterday. Geraldo, how's your nose?
Great. Thanks, Geraldo. See you later.
My biggest concern about American Talk Television now is that it's become amateur hour. There's so many new kids on the block. I love the whole appeal to youth, but they have to realize that if they're doing real-life issues with real-life people on the studio stages, it's not show business. There are implications to almost everything that you do or say, and I just hope that they're professional enough to take infinite care of the most precious commodity in this business, the people who come and offer themselves and their stories. That's kind of the grist for our mill.
Get my producers for today's show.
Yeah, Gary's talking to him. I'll be right in.
Well, just bring him in.
Ready?
Front and center.
Okay.
Sell it to me. Sell it to me. You'll sell it to the world.
Laura. Laura was a cheerleader.
Yes.
Laura went to homecoming with Eric, who will be here. He was the captain of the football team.
Right.
And her friend Bettina is only here. Is also here.
And she played volleyball.
She played volleyball.
And was a cheerleader.
Right. She kind of was the all-American girl, mm-hmm. very sort of, you
perfect.
Know, conservative yeah. and perfect and all this
Look
stuff.
Look at this long hair. It's beautiful. Yeah.
Laura is now yeah. a punk.
This is great.
She's a punk. She's living an alternative lifestyle in
right.
San Francisco, and she's also gay.
We get it. And she's gay.
Which she they don't know any of that.
We got the football captain meeting his homecoming date, who is now gay.
Right.
All I have is my credibility. I mean, that's all I got. I mean, it's like any reporter. That's all you have. You lose it, and you purposely disregard it. And go for the quick fix and the big hit, you're dead meat. You're going to be dead meat.
Florida. I love that.
It's going to be great. Donnie, you're going
Good.
To be great.
I love ratings. I wouldn't be here today if I didn't start a little show called A Current Affair that got big ratings. That a lot of big movie studios in California said, he must be part of the rating success of this show. Let's hire him to do a talk show. And that's why I'm doing talk.
Today, the shocking true story that we've all read about but couldn't believe. A woman so afraid of her breast implants that she actually cut them out herself.
Laura Today, Thorpe is a woman who was so unnerved by the possibility of her implants being unhealthful. She ripped her implants out. It's a big story. I mean, didn't go to a doctor, didn't go to a doctor's office, didn't go to a hospital, ripped them out. That's great talk show material. And every talk show on the air at the time was after that story. Sally was after it. Phil was after it. I was after it.
Sally offered us a week vacation anywhere we wanted to go and spending money. You know, so I could get away from the media, mm-hmm. just go on a vacation.
Happening and talk to somebody who does help families with troubled teens and runaways. Stay with you.
For 4 days, we stayed in her studio so no one would see us and just kept us there all day, you know, and it was terrible. And then she puts us in a green room with guys that one guy he's talking about he has full blown AIDS, the other ones they got their tongues pierced, their nipples, and stuff like that. It was a circus show. The one guy could lift things with his penis. I'm going, oh, God. So I told my kids, come on, let's get out of this room.
She came to my office. She didn't look well. She said she wanted to do my show. I said I would be glad to. I think that we will give you a comfort zone that you need to do the show, and that's the way I like to talk to my guests, and I do talk to a lot of my guests, and at times I do convince people to come on the air personally.
When you went to Maury's show, did you think that you were going to go on the air?
Actually, that was a hoodwink deal. I went to say I was sorry that I would not be doing his show this time. I was going to do Sally's, and his producer's like piranhas, you know? They're yelling and screaming and telling me, well, Maury won't accept your apology if you don't do the show. And, you know, it was kind of, and Maury's really hurt that you did that.
Then the next thing I know, there is a big conflict between the Sally Jesse Raphael show and the Maury Povich show over whose guest Laura Thorpe was. I don't know the details.
It was a ridiculous fight to the finish, a competitive thing, which you know about in television. A woman, one show says she was booked here, one show says she was booked there. We had her in New York. She disappeared from the hotel. She taped Maury first.
They started throwing dresses at me. See if this will fit. Oh, we got to get nylons. So they got nylons, and then they got a big razor. And I'm like, geez, what are we going to... And they go, you're going to do the show. Only for a few minutes. Just do the show. Or else Maury will be very disappointed and stuff. And I'm not one to like people to be disappointed in me. So I was out there on the stage and I was tongue-tied. I didn't know what to do because I did not expect it.
Let's meet Laura Thorpe, a 39-year-old mother of five from New Mexico. Just 2 weeks ago at 1 a.m. in the morning in the privacy of her bathroom, she took a razor blade just like this one and attempted to perform surgery on herself. And we can't even imagine it. I mean, the audience now is breathless, and so am I. I mean, we want to clutch ourselves. Why would you want to do such a thing?
But he promised to tape it and use the tape after Sally Jesse Raphael did her show. But she threw a temper tantrum. Hey, she had all kinds of bodyguards around her for 4 days. I'm in her studio, and she never once says hi, bye, or kiss my hiney.
No one likes to let one get away.
You know, I'll tell you something. Maybe I've gotten old, honestly. I mean, who lost? We lost. I mean, we didn't have the guest the next day.
Yeah, I sliced from here to here. And when it opened, I was shocked because it wasn't saline. It was
silicone,
and it was yellow, and it was just coming out, and I'm going like this. It's like taffy.
We'll be back. This is some woman, Laura Thorpe.
There is a cynicism that all we do is put these people on to get a rating. I think it's more than that. I mean, I think we do things that we're very proud of, and we try to help some people, and I think we can help some people. That's not to say I'm the therapist, but at least we can possibly be the driver of the ambulance.
I can't believe we're not getting more questions about what went on in that bathroom.
We don't pull surprises. We don't do that. We have always been able to tell our guests, this might happen, or this might happen, or this might happen. And whatever might happen, might happen. And they know about it. They're never shocked. They're never surprised. I mean, it's the marching orders that I have given my staff. We're just not that kind of show.
Joining us now is a prominent New York City plastic surgeon, Dr. Joseph Pober. Doctor, what do you think of what Laura did?
Well, it's horrendous.
I've appeared on several talk shows, and what surprises me is how, when you're on, things can happen which are totally beyond your expectation or control. For example, the Maury Povich talk show, when I first arrived, I had no idea that I'd be on the show with a woman who just slashed her breasts open with a razor blade in her bathroom. I thought I'd be talking about breast implant surgery and the pros and cons of silicone and saline-filled implants, which I'm comfortable discussing. And
were
suddenly,
you comfortable on the show?
Not at all. Not at all. I was surprised to be on the show with someone who just victimized herself that way. And I said, I felt very badly about being on a show like that.
When the plastic surgeon came out on the stage, I was so incensed. I could not believe he found, and I know that it was all premeditated to get me to do that show. Because how did they get the plastic surgeon?
After the show, I think you may have heard that I, having heard her story, not that she looked necessarily so sick, she looked fairly fine, but complications can occur from self-imposed surgery. There's certain tragedies that can occur. She needed to be examined by a doctor.
Well, I had a rampant infection. And He goes, oh, my God. And he took pictures of it and everything and told Maury I needed to go to the hospital. The doctors came in and they were, you could die from a massive infection like that. You could die.
I was contacted by another talk show.
By the Sally Jesse Raphael
show? Yes, I was contacted by the Sally Jesse Raphael show. And they contacted me that evening to discuss the appearance of Miss Laura Thorpe again on another show the following day. And it was explained to me that she was booked to be on the show. And I explained to the producers, I believe, who came to my office that evening that she was in the hospital currently and really required medical attention, and it would be medically inadvisable to release her until her surgery the following day.
I got a phone call. And there had been so many phone calls to me. The nurse who was in charge that night, she goes, will you please tell them to stop calling? And as everybody was calling, I don't know who they all were, but when I got the Sally people, and they goes, you have to sign out, or else if you can do the surgery at 3 o'clock in the morning, get there and do that show. And I goes, I don't think so, you know. And then she says, well, if you don't take that show tomorrow, we will sue you.
First of all, I've heard the story. It's not true. Okay,
that's not true.
I've heard the story, and I know that the Sally Show would not do that.
The Sally Show would not do that.
I didn't say that. I'm saying that nobody would tell someone throw them out of the street or anything like that. That we wouldn't do.
Did the producer get fired in that specific case?
Don't recall. To tell you the truth, I don't recall.
She knew I didn't have the money for cleanup surgery. Here was an opportunity I could have had.
I can speak on behalf of myself, my company, our show. I don't believe we would ever do that.
Well, I signed out of the hospital, got ready for the show. She calls up, and Barry had just gotten up there and said, well, we're not going to take her. Send her home. Here she puts on this air of, I care about everybody. People need not believe these people. They don't care about you. They're only caring about you till the segment's over, and that's it.
I guess what I'm asking is what you're saying, so long as people are watching, it's okay?
No. First of all, we have a certain amount of taste. We watch the shows constantly. I'm responsible for the shows, you know, for the Sally Show and for the Jerry Show. We're watching it. We're changing things. We're making sure that what we do is okay.
Everybody has to remember, all these shows, all talk shows are taped. We're not live. We can edit out anything we want. We don't have to show anything. Horla didn't have to show that fight. Phil could have said, I don't like me in a dress. I don't want, forget it. I don't like it. Cut it. I've killed shows. We all have that ability. That's a great power to have, and it doesn't have to happen. So something went haywire.
I was here at the house, and I got a phone call from my cousin and from a friend, and they told me to turn on Channel 17, that the Charles Perez Show was on.
What would you do if your sister asked you to leave your husband? All right, well, meet Kimberly and her sister, Chrissy. Kimberly says that Chrissy's husband is blue-collar scum.
My sister Kim and a friend of hers named Janice were on there, and they were talking about white-collar versus blue-collar workers, and Janice was saying that she was me.
Here's the question. Is love more important than money?
But my husband works hard. Okay, I'm going to school to work hard. So,
but wouldn't it be sad if you lived your whole life with money and then died without having lived it with love?
What were you feeling as you were watching this?
How many people were watching this, and how many people were going to think that my husband and I were having marital problems and the things that they were saying weren't true?
Why are you just going
to... 2 or 3 days before they went to do the taping of the show, Alexandria from the Charles Perez Show called me, and on 2 different occasions called me and asked me to come on the show. And she also tried to get my mother on the show, too, with a mother-daughter incident. And I told her, no, I wasn't interested. You know, I didn't want to come on the air. And then she had a producer come on, some gentleman, I don't know his name, and tried to talk me into doing it by offering me $100.
My show is a young show that's out there to do good things for young people. Talk about things that a lot of people aren't talking about.
Has the Charles Perez Show ever knowingly put an imposter on the air?
I cannot comment on that right now.
Why?
You know, it's for legal reasons. But I will say this, not specific to that event. We've never done anything knowingly that was in any way fabricated or in any way was anything other than legit and putting putting people up there who want to be on TV.
What occurred when Kimberly and Janice arrived at the studio?
Janice was asked to sign a paper, and from what she tells me, that she said, you know, she's not Chrissy, she can't sign my name, but she'll sign her name. And they told her no, she was going to be playing me, she had to sign my name.
Does your sister have a point at all? Do you want to work your whole life?
No, I don't want to work my whole life.
Christina, so wake up.
Apparently, they were messing up their lines, so they made some big white cards for them to read off of. And during one of the commercials, they told Kimmy to grab a hold of her, shake her, and say, Christina, wake up, you know, smell the coffee or something like that.
So wake up.
You don't want him.
You do not want
Jack. She doesn't know. She has no idea.
She doesn't want him.
When they came back on and she shook her, she didn't say Christina, she said Janice. And the things that they were saying weren't true.
He comes home
every night, sits on the couch, puts his hands like this.
Honey, where's dinner?
When my sister says that my husband sticks his hand in his pants, slouches on the couch and says, honey, where's my dinner? And he doesn't do that. My husband's not like that.
If you look at the shows that I do, I am very conscious about stepping back and asking myself the question before I go out there. What is this show really about?
If you could sit down with Charles Perez, what is it that you would like to ask him or say to him?
Why? Why he did it? You know, didn't he think about there's really a Chrissy Daly out there, you know, and how I would feel, how my husband would feel? He didn't think about that. Well, I had to call quite a few different numbers to finally get to the producers, and I told them that this person on the show is not me. You know, I knew who she was. Her name was Janice. That's not me, and the things they're saying aren't true.
Was the Charles Perez show not notified by this woman's attorney that, in fact, you had put on an imposter, and the show was rerun?
I don't know the specifics of that situation.
Charles, the show was rerun.
I'll tell you, I don't know the specifics of that situation, and I'm not going to comment.
He's lying. He's lying because I have the proof. I have the tape. The release forms say Christina Daly or Chrissy Daly, and I didn't sign them, and that's not me. You know? And I seen him on Good Morning America, and they asked him then if he lies or has people come on, you know, impersonate people. He said no, and he's lying.
For tickets, right to the Charles Perez show.
I love talk shows. I'd sit and watch them and, you know, talk to my friends on the phone about this one and that one, and I don't watch them no more. I don't believe in them. They're all lies. I think it's fake. Everyone who comes on the show, they're told what to say. They're not who they say they are. They just pay the people to do it.
We're going to take a little break. When we come back, we're going to meet two sisters, and one of those sisters has a very big secret to tell. The other one will be back right after this.
What was your understanding of what the show was going to be?
Something dealing with an old boyfriend or something to do with an old boyfriend, and they couldn't tell me the topic. They wanted it to be a surprise.
Joining us right now are Kimberly and her sister Yvonne. Thank you very much for being here, lady.
What did you say to her?
That I didn't want to be humiliated, I didn't want to be angered, or I didn't want to be embarrassed because I've seen the shows before and I've seen people done like that, and I didn't want to be done like that. Well, she said Kimberly had written to her and the story was great and they wanted to put us on TV.
Maybe I'll ask you this, Kimberly. There was a relationship that Yvonne was involved in that you weren't, you know a little bit about this guy. What was going on in that relationship?
Before I even start, I just want to let everybody know that I care very deeply for my younger sister. I would never do anything to hurt her.
I called Kim up and I asked her, Kim, are we really going on the Montel Williams show? And she said, yes, aren't you excited? And I'm like, what's the topic? And am I going to hate you after the show? And she goes, no, it's something to help you get on with your life.
The way that this started is because of a gentleman that she was dating and has been seeing off and on still for a while. And
how long is a while?
I guess going on 14 years, just made 14 years.
I thought I was going to see an old boyfriend that I haven't seen in years. And I thought it was going to be good, you know, seeing somebody that I hadn't seen in years, seeing what they were doing with their life or how their life was going on.
What about this guy?
She always asks me, why do I not like him? She, even this morning and last night, asked me why I don't like him.
Well, then wait a minute. Yvonne, who is this guy? I mean, you don't have to say his name, but he's somebody that you've been with for a while. Is that right? You've been dating him for a while?
Yeah. 14 years.
And during that whole period of time, I understand that there was a period there where he was a little abusive.
And then Montel goes, so Yvonne, you were in an abusive relationship. What? What are you talking about? I mean, you know, this is what clicked. I'm supposed to be meeting an old boyfriend. Nothing to do with, you know, what's going on in my life now or what's had been going on in my life.
And, I mean, now, Kimberly, you got caught in the middle of all this. Is that right?
I did, several times.
How?
I was doing something to help her.
And just what were you doing to help her?
I had sex with him to get him off of her back.
How can you sit there and tell me you've been sleeping with my boyfriend for 14 years and I've been sleeping with my boyfriend for 14 years and you're my sister? What are you doing to me? That's the kind of things that were like rushing through me. What is wrong with you? Why are we here? Why are you telling me on TV? There was, I don't know, just a whole bunch of things going through my head at the time, but I couldn't talk.
He was beating my sister, and she's on the other end, and I'm not the kind of person to want to see somebody hurting my sister.
And I've got to say that Yvonne, Yvonne is hearing this right this second for the very first time.
Yeah, I wanted to get out of there after that. Why stay there? She's been sleeping with my boyfriend. Why be taped about this? What was there to be focused on? I didn't see any need for me to be there.
Well, I want Yvonne to explain something. Yvonne, you're still seeing this guy off and on, is that right?
Yeah. I didn't know about this, okay? I had nothing, no idea.
And now that you do know, are you going to continue to see this guy?
I don't know what I feel right now. I'm in shock.
I tell you what, we'll take a little break, and when we come back, we'll talk to a sex expert who will give us some insight into what's going on with all these people. We'll be back right after this.
And the lady comes on the stage, and as she's passing me, I ask her to unhook me. I could still move then. I could still talk. And she wouldn't unhook me. She said, I can't. And after she said that, I was totally like...
I believe she's strong enough now. She's gone through a few different things. She's changed her life. And I just feel that she's strong enough. And I also feel that it's time that I get it out.
On national TV.
They lied about I wasn't going to be embarrassed. They lied about I wasn't going to be angered or humiliated. That was enough for me. Because all of the above, everything, the whole reason why I was there was a total lie.
Do you remember when I lived on Sonoma there? Yes. I said no to this man.
Why didn't you tell me I was right there?
Because you couldn't take it then, Yvonne.
What makes you think I'm taking it now?
And they chose to take me on the stage and let my dumb sister tell me she's sleeping with my boyfriend the same amount of time as I've been sleeping with him. What do they think was going to come out of this situation? What? Was I supposed to pull out an Uzi and kill somebody? Was I supposed to beat her up for telling it? What were they expecting from this? Is my question.
She had said to me in life several times before this happened that I wasn't there for her when we were kids, okay? There were things that happened. You don't know. I mean, you can be judgmental. I don't mind that. Each has his own life, okay? Something happened to us as children, okay? And when she would say to me, I wasn't there, then, but I had a chance to be there now.
It's just unreal. Why? Why do you want to do something to someone like that? What gives these talk shows and their, what should I say, producers the right to do this to people, number one, and then send you home, you know, without a care, and never even contact you again to see how your life is? Are you all right? Nothing.
Exactly. I went to a psychiatrist to find out. Why, you know, I mean, I went for counseling.
Wait, Kimberly, hold it, wait a minute. You went to counseling over this yourself?
Because I got extremely sick, yes.
Hold on.
What do you feel towards Montel Williams in your heart?
In my heart?
Or in your fist, wherever.
hate him. I hate him.
I'm sorry. I don't understand this. You went to counseling yourself.
I did.
Yet you were willing to bring your sister here on national television.
This was years ago I went to counseling,
but it still bothers me now. You needed the counseling then to even deal with it yourself, but you brought her out here and told her right here.
Only because
when you watch those shows, there are every day somebody who's being humiliated, traumatized. You know, there's somebody that's sitting up there looking really stupid because they're in shock. They need to cut that out. These are just everyday people who think going on TV is going to, you know, like boost them somewhere. And it isn't. It's just ripping them apart.
Scott looked out the door and saw him. And Scott tried to shut the door. And Schmitz put the gun in between the door and the door jamb to hold the door open. Then Scott backed up and he grabbed a chair and he went into the kitchen. He was backing away. Then Schmitz shot him. And Scott stood there for a moment and put his hands to his chest. And then he started to fall, went down to his knees, and Schmitz shot him again. Scott knew that he was going to die. It was a terrible thing to know that somebody's coming after you with a gun and there's no way out.
Now, which of these ways would you choose to reveal your secret crush on someone? A, would you write that person a letter? B, would you tell the person in private in case he rejects you? Or C, would you tell that person that you're gay and you hope he is on national television? And Scott, now Donna has been helping Scott pursue his secret crush on John. John's backstage, he can't hear us. How bad's the crush? Tell me about the first time you met him. Where was he?
He was under a car, working on her brake line.
Yeah? And that was your first time? What was your first impression?
I only saw the lower half of him, so you can imagine. He was hot.
Okay, you think about him, you have fantasies about him?
I've had a couple, yeah.
Yeah, you had when he was under the car, you had a fantasy about him.
Yeah, something to do with like brake oil line snapping and.
I think Scott went on the show not with an intention of embarrassing anybody. I think Scott went on the show thinking this was going to be a spectacular way that he could show somebody that he cares about them. Mm-hmm. Sort of like I don't know if in your days of being single. There's a girl you really like. You want to try and come up with something really neat to impress her.
Tell us about, you have another one that involved, you're in a hammock or something. Tell us about that fantasy.
I think she pushed him into things that he didn't really want to do. Like, Scott was very nervous.
Tell us about that fantasy.
Jenny Jones told them to make it look good for the audience or she would be very mad. And they offered Scott to give him flowers, and Scott wouldn't do it. Wanted Scott to kiss John, Scott wouldn't do it.
I got a pretty big hammock in my yard, and I thought about tying him up to my hammock.
And?
Well, it entails like whipped cream and champagne, stuff like that.
Now, John, he knows you're gay, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Do you know that he is?
No.
Anything's possible.
You're living in the 1990s. It isn't hard to offer somebody, a young, impressionable person, the opportunity to appear on national television, to express a secret crush, something that he doesn't feel necessarily bad about. He doesn't understand the dangers.
What is it that's so exciting about him to you?
He's got a cute little hard body. when you just want to pick up and put in your hero cabinet, you know, dust him off once in a while.
You want to physically pick him up?
Oh, he's just a tiny little cute thing. He's gorgeous.
Well, all right, let's see if he really is. Get the headphones off of John and let's have John come out here and see who has the crush on him. Here's John. Did you think Donna had the crush on you?
Did I? No, we're good friends.
Well, guess what? It's Scott that has the crush on you.
You lied to me.
I mean, he's confronted with this horrible situation on national television. You can see when you watch him, his hands go to his face in humiliation and embarrassment. And Jenny Jones exploits that and keeps twisting the knife and twisting the knife.
Before we talk, take a look at, we'll show a little playback of what Scott said about you, John. Take a look at that monitor
right here.
Down there.
Well, it entails like whipped cream and champagne, stuff like that.
Scott was pretty open about, he's been fantasizing about you since he saw you under that car for the first time. He had an under the car fantasy and he had a hammock fantasy he's been telling us about. Did you have any idea that he liked you this much?
No, I did not.
Can you tell us what your status is? I mean, you involved with anybody or?
No, but I am definitely a heterosexual, I guess you could say.
He'd been engaged to a woman for 3 or 4 years. And they had broken up several months earlier. He thought probably it was she, and if not the ex-girlfriend, someone else he had met at work with whom he thought there was a spark between the two. And so he was fantasizing. He gets on the airplane. Before even he gets on the airplane, he goes out and he buys a suit of clothes, a sport jacket, and a pair of slacks, and a new shirt, and a new tie, and I think even new shoes. And he gets himself all spruced up because he is now convincing himself that this is going to be the turnaround event in his life. This time, if it is his old girlfriend, he tells everybody at work, this time he's going to marry her.
Donna lives upstairs from me, and Scott was the guy one night I pulled in. She was looking at her brakes, and I was looking at the brakes too, and Scott pulls in behind me and goes, well, your car is pretty funny because I drew this peace sign in the back of my car, and it's, you know, it says peace man on it, and then Scott says, you look like a hippie in your car, and then you get out of your car. And then he told Donna that I was a good-looking guy. And Donna told me, and I said, well, you know, it's flattering, but...
It's flattering, but you're not interested? There's no way, right?
No, I'm you know, not...
Well, at least, Scott, at least you got it out. Are you very disappointed?
You can see her on the tape draining every last drop she can get out of it. She says to Jonathan, after he sees it's Donna Riley there sitting with Scott Amador, and he kisses Donna Riley, and Scott Amador, obviously set up for this, tries to embrace him, and he pulls away and avoids the embrace, sits down next to, in the only empty seat, next to Scott Amador, and as the audience hubbub kind of dies down, Jenny Jones from out in the audience says, so...
Did you think Donna had the crush on you?
Did I? No, we're good friends.
He gets halfway through the sentence, and she says, well, guess what?
Guess what? It's Scott that has the crush on you.
You lied to me.
His first reaction is to turn to Scott and to Donna and say,
yeah. You lied to me.
The bomb starts ticking at the moment Jenny Jones exposes with a big flourish and a huge audience reaction that it's in fact Scott Amador who has the secret crush on Jonathan, not Donna Riley. They leave the show, and Jonathan, still trying to act the gentleman, agrees to drive them home from the airport. The following morning, after staying up all the night before, drinking with friends from work, he goes home, and he sees a note written by Scott that, if you really want to get it off, I'm the only one who has the right tool. Jonathan sees this, and I think the bomb is really going off at that point.
You swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the true stuff you got?
I do.
The show that John appeared on March 6, 1995 was Ambush Television?
No.
You knew on March 5, 1995 that John's secret admirer was not going to be a woman, didn't you?
Yes.
When he was asking who it was, and they said, well, we can't even tell you, it could be a man or could be a woman, he said, well, then forget it, I'm not interested. If it's a man, I'm not interested.
And
he said it often enough that finally one of them said, well, don't worry. We can't tell you who it is, but we've talked to her, and everything's going to be fine. You'll be fine. You're going to have a good time. We have the production notes, and it shows very clearly that he's not at all interested. He wasn't interested in anything unusual. It wasn't just he didn't want to go on a show with a man having a secret. He didn't want anything unusual.
I told him it could be a man or a woman. It was his choice to come on.
But you knew it was a man, didn't you?
Yes.
So saying it could be a man or could be a woman was a lie, wasn't it?
I don't think so. I told him it could be a man or a woman.
Could it have been a woman?
No.
But you told John it could have been a woman, right?
Yes.
Isn't that a lie? Told him something that it couldn't have been.
Sure.
So they finessed him. They finessed a very unsophisticated, regular kind of guy.
I've been in every green room I can think of. I've never seen a bottle of vodka in there. What the heck was Jenny Jones' show plying Scott Amador with vodka for? I'll tell you, to reduce the inhibitions and to make it even more sensational.
During the time you talked with Scott Amador at the hotel on March 6, 1995, isn't it true that you told him if he was nervous to have a few drinks before he came on the show?
None at all.
You never discussed that with him?
No. As a matter of fact, when he came into the room, he had a beer in his hand.
Did you talk with Donna Riley that morning?
Once she was in the green room.
Did you talk with Donna Riley that morning at the hotel or around the hotel?
No.
Did you talk with Donna Riley or Scott Amador on the telephone from someplace to the hotel?
I don't remember.
And is it your testimony here on your oath that you had no conversation with them about drinking a few drinks in the morning if they were nervous?
That is correct.
Ron, the producer, had told us the evening before because he saw that we were nervous, and he said, oh, just, you know, have a couple drinks and loosen up, you know, and you guys will be okay. And so that's what we did. We went to the bar.
And were the drinks free?
No, we had a tab there. They gave you so much money.
The show gave you so much money?
On the hotel tab, yeah. It was at the hotel bar.
This is a perfect example of a talk show resulting in death. There is absolutely nothing surprising about what happened in this entire case. Nothing surprising to me.
And even though you're not a psychologist or psychiatrist, you realize that John was suffering some type of humiliation and embarrassment, correct?
Absolutely not.
When John was looking over at Mr. Amador and Miss Riley and said, "You lied to me," you'd recognize that as a real concern on the part of one of your guests, that he was suffering some type of embarrassment or concern, wouldn't you?
Not in that context, no.
What do you mean by not in that context? Could you describe or explain?
Well, the show was a lighthearted show. No one seemed upset in that segment. And when he said that, what I got from that was that he had asked them, you know, was it you, John? Was it you, Scott? And Scott probably said no, and that's what that meant to me. There was nothing negative in that at all to me.
You might be able to do what they did to Jonathan Schmitz. You might be able to do it to 100 people in a row, and maybe only one or two or three would react the same way. Maybe only one or two or three would have the same demons inside when they're plucked out of obscurity and thrust unwanted into the national spotlight, humiliated publicly and nationally, and the humiliation is continued.
Miss Jones, did you ever think that if you didn't go for that extra little setup to pull that last bit of emotion out, that maybe this terrible tragedy which brings us together today wouldn't have occurred?
I don't know what you're talking about.
I have no further questions, Miss Jones.
This isn't the Jenny Jones case. This is the murder of Scott Amador case. Keep this in mind. If we're talking about whether you should be sympathetic for that defendant for what happened on the Jenny Jones show, think about what he did to Scott Amador.
I see him standing there with smoke coming out of his chest. Every night, I don't sleep. It's hard. And I expect him there all the time. And I just picture this hole with smoke coming out of him. And it's like living in a movie. It's not really happening.
On someone of the same sex and want to do it here on the show and reveal your crush, call us at the show. We'll do this again. And the number to call is 312-836-9400.
Everything that was nasty, everything that was mean, everything that was demeaning ended with that Jenny Jones show.
But this is an interesting issue, you know. Someone is dead. A
a person who was embarrassed on national television by another man who said he had a crush on him killed him. And everybody blamed the talk show. What killed him, it looks like to me, was homophobia.
The true responsibility lies in the hands of the alleged murderer, not the talk show. And that, you know, an ambush and a revelation that someone gay loves you is not exactly, you know, generally accepted as a self-defense to a homicide. Still, the talk show had some culpability, and there was some causal relationship between that show and that homicide. And so it's almost like the life of Tupac Shakur. Suddenly the lyrics became real, and we all understood that there is enormous responsibility when you bring someone on a stage and talk about something so raw and so personal.